the only man ever to have won an Oscar for Cabaret, Emmy for Liza with a Z, Tony for Pippin, all in the same year. The man who brought us Sweet Charity and Cabaret and Dancing and Pippin and so many, I could never name them all right here, but he is back. Bob Fosse is back, and so our hearts leap up as we look forward once again to some of the best singing and the best dancing there is to be had on Broadway. Bob Fosse has a new big musical on Broadway called Big Deal, and what's the source of it?
It's from an Italian film made in the 50s called Big Deal on Madonna Street.
It's about an incompetent bunch of crooks.
Yeah.
But you changed it from Italy.
Yeah, I started working on this about 18 or 19 years ago with my usual speed. It's just coming to Broadway now. And it's gone through many, many changes. At one time, I had put the locale in Tijuana, Mexico. And now it is in the Depression period in the mid-30s in Chicago, basically a black neighborhood.
One of the most interesting aspects of Big Deal is that instead of hiring a composer and a lyricist to write a new score, you have taken some very famous music from the 1930s and adapted it for the show.
Yes.
In fact, there's one moment in there that's almost a joke when a guy tries to con a judge in a courtroom and the judge sings, "I got a feeling you're fooling," which is not what that song is about at all. You know, it's a love song.
I have distorted the meaning and the placement of those songs a great deal to suit my own sense of humor and fun about the show. It was fun not having to argue with composers all the time. And also, I think a lot of composers don't want to work with me anymore.
The casting in the show is very interesting because the male star, Cleavon Derricks, I saw in Dreamgirls on Broadway. Is that the first time you ever saw him work?
I didn't see him in Dreamgirls. I saw him in a film called Moscow on the Hudson.
He was the cop, the security guard in Bloomingdale's.
That took Robin Williams in to live in, with his family, yes. And I thought he was just fantastic in that. And he came in and read through the script with me, and I just think there's nobody like him. I can't say enough nice things about that guy and how talented I think he is.
And the girl is from Dreamgirls.
Mm-hmm.
What's her name?
Loretta Devine.
That's her real name?
I don't know. But she is divine, I can tell you that.
Now, there's one great number among many in the first act when a bunch of convicts are singing Ain't We Got Fun,
yeah,
in which you distort the rhythm.
Every morning, every evening, ain't we got fun.
There's a wonderful dance in there. Are you proud of that dance? I mean, that dance
convict
is...
Convict dance.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that a lot, yes.
Now, is that an inspiration that came at once, or is there a lot of hard work in that dance from your point of view?
I think I redid that one two or three times. It didn't work the first time. And then I got the idea of a percussive chain gang, and that seemed to propel me into the dance. Because they do these chains in rhythm.
The chains really work.
I think so, yeah.
You must be one of the very few directors on Broadway whose name on the marquee is the attraction. A Bob Fosse musical, people expect a certain quality, a certain caliber show, and they get it.
Well, that's nice to hear that.
Does it make you feel good? I mean, do you have that feeling about yourself, that I am Bob Fosse?
No, I don't quite realize that, and sometimes when I look up in the balcony and see a few empty seats, then I think, let's put somebody else's name up there, anybody.
Do you find, as you go on in your career, that choreography is more difficult? Are you repeating yourself, or do you constantly find new ways to express yourself in dance?
Choreography has always been difficult for me. I mean, when I first started directing felt very easy compared to choreography. I mean, I really stay up nights trying to think of it. It gets harder because my body just doesn't move, you know? I mean, my mind is moving and jumping and pirouetting, but the body won't do it anymore. And the kind of dancing I do, there is not a very big vocabulary for, as there is in classical ballet. So I have to demonstrate, and I don't demonstrate as well as I used to. So it does hold me up a little bit. a lot of the stuff that I'm doing now in dancing, I've done before. I just think maybe I'm doing it a little better, a little more precisely. It's like I'm singing my song again. I just think I'm singing a little better.
When you were very little, did you start to dance just instinctively?
Yeah, I came from a very large family. I had a lot of brothers. They were all very tall, like you. They're 6 foot, and they all were into sports, and I was this little runt. And it was pretty tough around that house to get attention. So since I couldn't play basketball or football or anything very well, I started dancing around, and that's how I got my attention.
That's interesting. When did you first start to study?
9 years old.
9 years old. Mm-hmm. Your parents had no objection? They thought that was a good idea?
Well, I asked to study. There was a girl who lived 2 doors down who I had a big crush on, and she went to dancing school, so I thought, well, this is my chance to be very friendly with this girl, so I went with her.
Did you have more fun in life when you were a performer?
No. I threw up twice a day when I was a performer. Now I throw up 3 times a day, so it's it's about equal.
Big deal cost $5 million.
That's what they
probably tell me. Oklahoma, South Pacific, Carousel combined didn't cost $5 million.
I'm sure they didn't. The first show that I directed was in the late 50s, a show called Redhead, and I know that cost $200,000.
What happened?
I don't know. It's changed a great deal, the theater, I can tell you that. It feels a lot different to me now than when I first came into the theater.
Marvin Hamlin said something interesting to me. He said it used to be show business, now it's show business.
That's cute. He's right. He's very right about it.
It's a different feel.
Yeah, and they're all after this big major hit all the time. So I have nothing against hits. I'd love to have as many hits as possible, and I think Big Deal can be a hit and will be. But the pressure on you to have this enormous hit is just a bad thing. What it does is it makes you not take as many risks as you should take.
How hard do you work in auditions? How many people do you see among dancers before you cast a show?
For the ensemble, you mean, in Big Deal? I would say that I saw 1,500.
1,500?
For 10 jobs.
Now, when you say that, is that like the beginning of All That Jazz, when the camera pulled back and we saw 400 people on stage at once? Does that count that you saw 400 people?
Yeah, and it is difficult to pick them up. First of all, you shouldn't look at faces at the beginning.
Really?
No, I just squint and look at bodies and see how much training they've had. Then I make the combinations a little more difficult as the audition progresses to see who can learn quickly, because learning quickly is important in a musical.
You can tell by the way a person dances what kind of training they've had?
Yes, pretty much.
Is that so?
Sure.
What do you see? Can you explain to a layman what you're looking for?
Well, you see turnout, you see extension, which means how they lift their leg. Whether they distort their body, how they carry, their posture, their balance, if it's a pirouette, whether they can hold their balance, all of those things you can see very, very quickly. It is when you get down to later, and in musicals now you need so much from dancers, they not only have to dance well, they have to be able to sing and act somewhat. So that's when it gets tougher, and then you do start looking at faces as the elimination continues.
Bob Fosse is one of the most inventive, successful and honored people in the theater. You still have a nervous stomach waiting for reviews?
Yeah. I thought as I got older that I would be immune to that kind of pain. But it's not. And frequently it makes you nervous about your own talent and whether you really have it or you don't have it. Or maybe at my age you're worried about maybe I had it, maybe I'm losing it, you know, because I guess that happens to everybody at some time, that over the hill feeling. The thing is, you see, it's not just me. When you think about the show, I mean, if I had a choice and they want to say Bob Fosse is the worst director that ever tried to direct a show and is the most mundane choreographer, but the show is great and the actors are great, go see it. I would take that review anytime. It is the people that you fall in love with on a show, the actors that you have this camaraderie with, and you, there's a kind of, maybe it's phony show business, and God knows I've been anti-show business, but there is a kind of affection where everybody's pushing for the same thing, and I just don't want to let them down. That's all.